What is up, my peeps? Joshua Smith here at GSD Studios. First off, I want to thank you for watching the show. I truly appreciate your support. I know it's annoying, but please listen to the entire intro before the podcast begins, as I really need your help. So before we jump in, just a few quick favors, you guys. Number one, please share the show with anyone you feel that will benefit. This truly helps grow the show and has a massive impact on many lives. So please go out there, share the show. Sharing is caring, right? Number two, if you have not already, make sure that you subscribe to my YouTube channel. Please leave a 5-star review on iTunes and in Stitcher, again, if you have not done so already. Number three, make sure that you join the private GSD Mode Facebook Mastermind group. If you go to www.gsdmode.com, you'll see a link, a button right there on the homepage that you can click and request to be added to that group right away. And lastly, I want to give our sponsors a quick shout out that make this show entirely possible. Our first sponsor is my personal 90-day mastery bootcamp. This is my personal mentorship training program where I give you everything that I do inside my business. You get my entire playbook, you guys. We have 12 live, 3+ hour long sessions. Each session we go so in depth on exactly what I do inside my real estate team and how I operate my business. Plus there's a lot of different bonus sessions. You get access to everything I do inside my business on my tracking forms, presentations, checklists, lead generation tactics, lead follow-up tactics, team contracts, and much more. There's absolutely nothing that I withhold from you that you don't get access to. Plus you get daily access to me inside the group. So this is hands down the most effective and affordable real estate training program on the planet. Check us out, www.90daymastery.com, or click the link below to learn more about that. If you do join, make sure to plug in promo code LiveMastery, that's all caps, all one word, all together, which will save you $500, make the whole entire program only $997, or three payments of $333. Our next sponsor number two is PerfectStormNow.com. This is an insanely effective lead generation website for realtors and now offers not just the front-end website, but a website and CRM combo with all my personal written follow-up drips and scripts. And some of these, you guys, go out 1,000+ days. We made it where it's 100% dummy-proof. And this system, you guys, competes with $1,000+ month systems that exist in the industry, and it's only $199 per month. So make sure to check us out, www.perfectstormnow.com, where you can check out in-depth demos, client testimonials, more info, all that fun stuff. Our third sponsor is EMF. I'm really excited about this one. This is Optimized Life Nutrition's newest supplement, newest nootropic. It's by far the most powerful nootropic on the planet. EMF stands for Energy Memory Focus. If you're like me and you want to have insane energy, improved memory, extreme intense focused, this is the best product, you guys, that money can buy. I take it every single day and the results are insane. Improved energy, improved focus, improved mood, awareness, and we've even had many clients tell us to improve sex, dude. So it's just this crazy, insane, overall life-enhancing product. So check that out at www.optimizelifenutrition.com. Lastly, if you want to be like me and the crew here at GSD Studios, kicking ass every single day, highly recommend that you rock your GSD gear here on the website, www.gsdmode.com. Snag your shirts. We have women's shirts, men's shirts. I got some hats. We got a lot more apparel on the way. So that's all I got for you guys. Hope you enjoy the show, and we will talk to you soon. What is up, my peeps? Joshua Smith here with another GSD Mode interview. Every single week, we interview top entrepreneurs and just straight up top badasses that are out there dominating their spaces. These are people choosing to not live a life of mediocrity, but instead to go out there and create big, amazing, epic lives for themselves and their families, and of course, have a big impact on this planet while they're here. So today, you guys, we have an absolute true badass, somebody that's actually trademarked the name Badass Soul-Seeking Warrior. So our guest today, you guys, is has an MBA from Harvard, is a serial entrepreneur, and the current owner of Meet Me at Your Barn. So really stoked and honored to have Amy Fonte on the show. Welcome to the show, my friend.
Thank you. From one badass to another, it's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, no, I'm excited. You've done and continue to do a lot of amazing big things, and I'm really excited to have you on the show and to be able to learn from you. And before we get into what you're doing today, because I know you're doing a lot of big things today, but I'm always interested in our guest journey, really that led them into entrepreneurship in the first place. So if we rewind the clocks to, whether that's something like high school, college, whatever that is, what led you into the entrepreneur path in the first place?
I would say that my journey began when I was 6 or 7 years old on a John Deere tractor on the plains of eastern Colorado. You know, I had the blessing to grow up on a farm. And because our dad needed the help, when we were quite young, my brothers and I would help with the farming. And so I had an office on wheels, if you would. The other thing I realized when I was quite young is that our family was not wealthy. And there was a struggle financially oftentimes for us. And as a small child, you see that and you really don't have many references for what that means and how that plays out over time. But I was convinced that that's not how I wanted to live my life. And so I remember being on those tractors for hours on end. And I thought, and I dreamed, and I imagined, and I always saw myself as I was older, carrying a briefcase with a business suit on and traveling around the world, because I knew there was something bigger and more abundant out in the world than what I was experiencing. So I think it started back then. And that journey led me through high school. I was an athlete, which was a nice opportunity for me to put myself through college. And then when I graduated from college, I went into banking for a bit. And one of the customers of the bank was a true entrepreneur. His name was Jack DeBoer, and he was the creator of the Residence Inn Company, which later was sold by him to Marriott Corporation. So I worked for Marriott for a bit and did a lot of dirt kicking, if you will, and purchased sites to build hotels on. And I was driving around the 128 corridor around Boston one day, and I was looking around and I thought, you know what? Anybody can do what I'm doing right now. I don't want to do what anybody can do. I want to do what my destiny is supposed to be. So that afternoon, I rolled over to Harvard and picked up an application. And that was a much more onerous project than I thought it was going to be. But I managed to get through the application process, and lo and behold, I was accepted. It was the only school I applied to, so I was a little bold as far as that went. And that was a good experience for me. It taught me a lot about how to learn and get to the bottom of matters quickly. After Harvard, I went to school for a venture-backed company that we eventually took public and moved to Atlanta from the San Diego area. I did not want to live in Atlanta. And my mom called me one day and she said, I met the nicest people at church. They have a daughter who lives in San Diego. I think you two should meet. And that is Kate, who's my current business partner in our physical therapy and wellness clinic. And it went on from there. We've invented several products. I've ran into other business partners along the way. And now I've recently created my own personal development company as well. So it's been a great adventure, and I've had a lot of fun and learned a lot.
Yeah, no, I love that. So, you know, we find with a lot of entrepreneurs that when they're kind of going down the corporate path, right, creating, you know, as you're creating success for yourself, but you're really building other people's empires. And we find that a lot of times you have like this internal war that's going on, just knowing that you're not going out there and being your own creator, if you will. I mean, did you have any of that going on at that time? I mean, did you always have an inkling as you're working in those more corporate spaces where, you know, you knew deep down that you wanted to be out there creating your own companies?
I did. And I also knew that those companies had a lot to teach me. They were in business. They had processes in place. They were successful. And I knew that my biggest asset would be patience as I went through the learning process as I was employed in those organizations. It wasn't going to benefit me or serve me to be in a hurry to get to where I wanted to get to and not take advantage of the wonderful assets and resources I had to learn from along the way. So I really, really appreciated that. And in addition to that, I even sought out mentors outside of those organizations.
Yeah, so it sounds like you kind of had the plan in place to always go on your own. It was just soaking up those learning experiences. And, you know, for so many driven people, patience seems to be like, their biggest vice, if you will, you know, the lack of patience. How did you stay so patient during those times to soak in those learning experiences and not kind of prematurely make the jump?
Well, you know, Joshua, when I was quite young, and I'll do the best I can to be brief and be brilliant and move on with this. But when I was quite young, I felt like there was a destiny out there for me, and it was up to me to find it and fulfill it. And I had a sense, an intuitive sense, that it wasn't a job to be rushed to, that it would unfold in front of me, but I had to patiently look for the signs and patiently learn from others more wise and mature than I was. And so it was more of an intuitive knowing for me than something that I read about or someone taught me. I just felt I really needed to take the slow road to China, if you would, and that has served me well.
Yeah, no, I love that. So then when you did your first venture, I mean, how did you know that was the right venture for you, because it sounds like the partnership's been very successful. You're still partners today. You know, but before this, you know, you talked about being in banking. I know you were in real estate, and, you know, then you kind of jump into a different path. How did you, you know that was right for you and not kind of stay in a similar path to what the companies that you were working for were doing?
Well, my business partner, Kate, was running her own private practice here in San Diego. And there was a transition time from fee for service in healthcare to where it was more managed care. And they teach you a lot of things in physical therapy school, but they don't teach you how to be a business person. And I was groomed to be a business person, right? So I'd spent the last 2 years of my life just seeped and marinating in how to look at spreadsheets and performas and all those kinds of things. And so when she proposed that I come on board with her, I didn't know anything about physical therapy. And so I said, you know what, let me come spend some time there. Let me look at your books. Let's look at what's going on here to see where we are. And to my astonishment, her company was hemorrhaging from every line item on the P&L. And so I looked at that, though, and I saw the opportunity there. So I said to her, here's what we're going to do. You go focus on the clinical side of this business. Keep the therapist focused. Let's make sure that our plans of care are what they need to be. We're taking really good care of the patients. I'm going to focus on getting this company turned around. And I said to her, it's going to be a bloodbath, so hang on. It's not going to be fun. There's going to be some rough days ahead. But I know a year from now, if we get to the other side of this, then we can move on to other things. And that's exactly what we did. I really just went through each of the line items on the P&L and looked at the opportunities for us to renegotiate or turn things around. And the good news, when I first looked at the company and I learned more about the industry and the demographics of who our customer was, it was very evident to me that we had a huge opportunity to grow and be successful. We just didn't have all the pieces in the right places yet.
Yeah. No, I love that. So it sounds like to me, through all your experiences, like you kind of identified, you know, what your entrepreneur superpower was, you know, right? And were able to stay there. And I think a lot of people have a tough time figuring out what their own superpower is. How did you, I know through experiences you got probably clarity on that just from working with these other companies, but what kind of advice would you give for other entrepreneurs or those that are maybe getting into entrepreneurship on how to identify what their strengths are, whether they're doing a strategic partnership or not, but what those strengths are, what they should really be focusing on?
Well, I think there's a lot of different things we can talk about when it comes to that. One is to really take note of what you're attracted to, what you feel you're good at, when you go to in a room, in a meeting, what draws you to enter into the conversation. So you start to learn about who you are and what really excites you about life or business. And then past that, for me, the one thing I always did is I said, if you look at the world and ask the question, what doesn't work for me or what's not working for other people, and you go fix that problem, then you've got yourself something. And so that's kind of how we did it. We looked at the world from a physical therapy standpoint, and we knew that there was a very specific knee challenge that people had all over the world. 1 in 4 people in the world get this at some point in their life. And I looked at my business partner, I said, we got to fix this. This is our opportunity to help a whole hell of a lot of people, and we can help fix this. And that's what we did. That's how we started with our first invention, actually in patent, which was the OnTrack system for patellofemoral dysfunction. And we went on from there with other products as we moved through.
Yeah, no, I love that. So we're turning that company around, because I know that you said, you know, it was going to be a bloodbath, you know, right? There's so many entrepreneurs struggle so much, you know, right? I don't know the exact statistic, but it's something like 80% fall in the first 5 years, then year 6 through 10, another 80% fall out. So with your experience and seeing these struggling companies, but also, you know, your proven track record, turn these companies around, you know, what are some of the biggest mistakes that you're seeing that entrepreneurs that may be brilliant at what they're doing, may be a brilliant physical therapist, but have no idea how to run the back end of the business? You know, what are kind of some some common, few things that you see that most people are making these mistakes on?
I think the one thing I notice the most about entrepreneurs is they resist getting out of their own way, because none of us are good at everything. But if, as an entrepreneur, if we can determine what we are really good at and where we add value in our organization, and then surround ourselves with like-minded people who are good at what they do and add value in the different areas that we don't have the talent and the skill, and pull a team together like that, I think that takes us a long way. Entrepreneurs oftentimes, especially young entrepreneurs, I think suffer from the thoughts of, this is my idea, I know exactly what I'm doing, no one's gonna tell me what to do, no one's gonna come in here and change what my brainchild was, versus if we can let go of the ego part of that and come from a place of service and value, our whole perspective about running our business and creating a product or creating a service can change.
Yep, love it. So, you talked about when your upbringing on the farm and having that hardcore, and this is kind of an odd question, but I think it's important, or at least it's important for me to ask, because I've got three young kids myself at this point. You going through that experience and learning hard work, and but kids today have a totally different experience, right? Kids are behind their iPads playing Minecraft and doing different things, and what kind of advice would you give to parents today, maybe with young kids, to go out there and instill that same type of work ethic and that same experience that you got, even though that environment may not exist today? But, because the world has totally changed. Middle class is dissolving. The industrial age is over, right? It's like people need to kind of wake up in a whole different realm. Us as parents with young kids, how do you prep your kids to be able to kind of get that drive and that work ethic that you did?
Well, I think the first thing I would encourage parents to do, put your cell phone down and spend time with your kids. Have them put their cell phone down so you can spend one-on-one real time. I think the instruments have been brilliant in many ways by putting information at our fingertips 7/24. But I don't think the human being is equipped to handle all of that coming at them all the time. And it has to really start at home with the parents as far as a good role model and whatnot. And then there's all kinds of opportunities, regardless of where people live, to spend time in nature and to really get away from the hustle bustle and the drive-through, I want it now mentality. But that has to be really talked about as a mom and a dad. And then in a family, you have to be in alignment with all of that. So if you decide you're going to sit down every afternoon or every evening at 6 o'clock for family dinner with no interruptions, that means that's what you do. You turn the TVs off, you put the cell phones away, you close the computers down, and you really start to practice from a really young age with these kids that this is how we're going to live our lives as a family. And then there's going to be distraction from the outside world, but that doesn't mean we don't stick together as a family. We don't live by the family rules we've made for ourselves. And then there's always opportunities to send these kids or go with these kids to a farm. There's a lot of places in the world that are still operating and thriving that these kids can have a summer experience. And I would highly recommend it for people. Parents of kids. Yeah.
Love that advice. So, you got clarity at a young age, it sounds like, from kind of knowing what you didn't want, right? Because a lot of people are like, hey, I don't know, everybody talks about getting clarity of what you want in this world. A lot of people don't know how to go there. But you kind of got it from a different experience of being in an environment of knowing, hey, man, this isn't the lifestyle that I want going forward, to help you get to the clarity of what you did want. What kind of advice do you give people that, know they want more for their life, but they have this like empty hole because they just don't know how to get clarity on what they truly want, or hear all this word of purpose that gets thrown around? How do you even start with that?
Well, I think it's an inside job. You've probably heard that term before, but I really do believe it's true. We have to go inside and get to know who we are. And that means asking yourself, what are your values? What are your top three values? What brings you peace? Are you satisfied that what you already have is enough? And starting from there. And so once you get clarity and really understand who you are from your essence, not from your ego, then it allows you to go outside of yourself and ask life, what do you need from me? And then fulfill what that answer is. I think sometimes we are too self-serving, internal about what's in it for me, and we're defined by how big our car is or what kind of house we live in or how much money we make, versus and resume building, right? Versus finding a vocation for ourselves. How can we be of service to others? And that's the best way to serve ourselves, I believe.
Yep, 100%. Yeah, I've yet to really meet anybody that's an uber successful self-made person that hasn't led from a place of contribution. It was never really about the money or the cars, or it was always, how do I make a bigger impact? How do I contribute? And they do that at such a high level, then the monetary success then follows.
Yeah, that's one of the things in all of our businesses and everything we've ever invented or gotten involved in is this must add value to other people's lives. This must be of service somehow. Otherwise, we're not going to do it. If it's just to make money, I'll take a pass on it. There's a lot of ways to make money. But for me and my business partners, one of our core values is this has to serve others. This has to help and make a contribution in the world. And this has to be sustainable for more than 10 minutes or 10 weeks or 10 years, right?
Yep. So when you, and I know I'm kind of jumping all over the place, but more questions keep coming up and I don't want to forget to ask them. So, you know, when you switch from, you know, really the more the corporate space to now you're, you know, full on entrepreneur, you've got your business partner, what were some of the obstacles that you initially had to overcome that maybe kind of shocked you? Cause now you're in a different role, you know, right? You know, were there any obstacles that you had to overcome, which I know there probably were a lot, but that you were really shocked and surprised and maybe didn't expect those?
Well, I suppose for me, the first real eye opener, and you know, I wasn't ignorant, but I didn't have that much experience at that point either, is when we created the OnTrack. We were just hardworking. My business partner and I would work in our clinic Monday through Friday, and then we would get on an airplane and travel somewhere in the country or the world, and go teach seminars all weekend and come back and be in our office on Monday morning and go through this process. We did that for 7 years. And the thing that we ran into is when you're successful like that, you can expect that other people, number one, aren't going to like you much. Number two, are going to want to knock you off. Or number three, think they can come up with something better. And that's all good. That's what competition is all about. But we experienced a company that wanted to license our product with their real intention was they wanted to put it on a shelf so it didn't compete with them. They're struggling against our product, you know, out in the marketplace. And we ended up licensing our knee brace to a company. And one of the things I negotiated through this license agreement was we wanted guaranteed minimum royalties. So it was, and they were pretty hefty because we wanted to hold their feet to the fire on making sure they weren't just going to put this on a shelf and not have a product because we were very successful with it. Unfortunately, they stopped paying the royalties and they were trying to put it on a shelf. And so we had to go through a lawsuit and go through all that mess, if you will. So the business world can be pretty gnarly. And you kind of have to be ready for anything, right?
Awesome. So we talk about that kind of work ethic and that kind of hustle, you know, because, I mean, the word hustle gets thrown around so much. It's kind of like this new fad word, you know, and I don't think a lot of people, you know, they say out there that most businesses fail because of lack of contribution. But, you know, I don't know if I agree with that. I mean, it seems like a lot of people just aren't prepared for the amount of time and action that it truly takes to go out there and succeed. They're not willing to grind 5 days a week like you were, than jump on airplanes and work every single weekend and go 7 days of their, you know, or 7 years working 7 days a week and no vacations, probably no weekends. And, you know, what kind of, when you're speaking with entrepreneurs or maybe even people that are wanting to start a new venture, what kind of recommendation would you give them or advice would you give them on what to be prepared for when it does come to those hours and that hustle? Because I think people just aren't always prepared for what's to come.
I agree with that. I'm kind of a quant jock because of my training. And so the first thing I recommend that entrepreneurs do is build your pro formas, your best case, your worst case, and your likely case scenario. And then throw the best case and the likely case to the side and figure out how you're going to make your worst case scenario work. And that, then, you know, the components of that are how many days a week is that going to take? What kind of travel are you going to need? What kind of funding are you going to need? What commitment are you going to have to make from yourself? What commitment are you going to have to sacrifice from a family standpoint? And you really have to decide if you're ready to do that, because it's a ball buster. It takes a lot of time and a lot of effort and a lot of energy, and you run into obstacles, And I think you have to have a state of mind that's unshakable, because you can get tossed around a lot out there. And if you don't have that state of mind that's okay, this is just another obstacle we have to overcome, we'll work around it. It's an opportunity for us to learn. It's an opportunity for us to make our product better. It's an opportunity to meet new people. That perspective certainly helps, for sure. And I think the other thing that I would encourage people to do is action is different than inspired action. You can spend a lot of time spinning your wheels and out in the world doing things and acting busy and creating all kinds of noise, but that's different than doing things that you have inspiration to do, that you know are value driven, and that will end up making a contribution not only to other people's lives, but to your bottom line and that evolution of creating a business into a thriving business and sustaining itself from that point moving forward.
Yeah, with the inspired action, because it's easy to be inspired in the beginning, to be pumped up, to be fired up, to be motivated, inspired in the beginning, you know. But then when you're, working that 7 days a week, 100-hour work weeks, and you're grinding, and coming amongst, you know, very, very tough times. I had a guest on the show that said entrepreneurship is smiles and cries, you know, right? And when you're going through that, how do you stay inspired for as long as it takes to go out there and create that success? Because again, man, when you're getting knocked down, that can be a difficult thing to do.
Couple things. The first thing I'm very focused on, and I use it as a GPS system for myself really, are my values. My top three values are integrity, appreciation, and abundance. And so I don't enter into any relationship, whether it's business or personal, if all three of those values aren't met. If one of them's not met, I won't enter into it. So it really keeps me out of the ditch, right? I have this saying, I say, keep your ass in the saddle. And those values, if I ask my question, is this deal or this relationship with this person or business or this situation going to have integrity about it on both sides of the table? Can there be appreciation around the table about it? And is it going to provide abundance? And not just financial abundance, but abundance of learning and contribution and serving others? Yeah, I'm going to do the deal, or I'll enter into that situation or that arrangement with whomever or whatever. If not, not going to do it. The other thing is, I think we really have to know ourselves. We really do have to know who we are and how we're wired, because everybody's wired different. And there's some personalities that are wired to be successful entrepreneurs, and there's some personalities that would like to be entrepreneurs, but the wiring's just not there. Nothing wrong with that, but I think we really have to know who we are from the inside out and know that's the foundation that we're going to build our companies or our thoughts on. And if you build it on sand, the success rate probably isn't going to be as abundant as if you have a really strong, solid foundation that you're building it on.
I love that. So, as you were, I hate the word failure, right? Because failure is how we learn, how we grow, and typically become our greatest assets. But through all your years of entrepreneurship, what have been like your best, a couple of your best learning experiences that really defined you to the person and the entrepreneur you are today?
I would say, and I don't mind the word failure. It's actually, I've actually made it a good friend of mine, because how many times when life's going well and you're flying high and everything's going your way, are you learning anything? The only time I've learned anything is kind of when I've gotten my ass kicked, right? Because that's when it gives you the opportunity to sit back and go, okay, what can I learn from this? How can I move forward? How can I be smarter the next time around? I would say going through the handful of lawsuits that I've been involved with has certainly been true learning experiences. Probably the best learning experience for me before I even got into entrepreneurship is when I was still at Harvard. And you probably know this. I don't know if all of your listeners would know this or not, but at Harvard, there's a forced curve. And so they flunk out 10% of the class. And your grade is dependent on one exam you take throughout the class and your class participation. And so I didn't come from legacy families, which a lot of kids do that go there. So for me, I really had to figure out a way to make it through it without flunking out, right? And I remember being there, and I had so little money, and I would walk from Harvard to my friend's house in Charleston, and there is a mall about halfway through, 6 miles one way. And I would sit there and I'd study. And this would be on a Friday or a Saturday. I would study. And because I didn't have anything to distract me, I was able to look at the construction of the mall, or I was able to watch people and really absorb and learn from them, versus if it would have been an easier trek for me, I don't think I'd have taken the time to learn those kinds of things. So I think if we can get comfortable with the discomfort in our life, that's where all the beautiful lessons are.
Yeah, I love that. So what then, you know, because I know you entered in, you talked about your first business and you've had many since then. You know, what led you to the path that you're doing now with Meet Me at the Barn?
Well, I, in October of 2007, my house burned to the ground. The 15-year relationship that I was in was also going up in flames, and we were in a lawsuit with a really big multinational company on a patent infringement case, and all of this was going on at the same time. And I thought, you know, I never had on my list of things to do build a house from the ground up, although it turned out to be a really great experience. Relationships, regardless of the circumstances, when they come to an end, it's hard. There's heartbreak involved. And I don't know if you've been in lawsuits or how many you've been in, but it's not that much fun. Even as a plaintiff, it was not that much fun, certainly not for the lighthearted. And I remember moving into my house once I got it reconstructed, and I had a challenge with the flooring vendor. So the only place that had flooring in the house were the hallways and the bathrooms. And so I didn't want to bring furniture and everything in because it'd have to be all taken back out, and I want to get this flooring thing sorted out first. So I walked in, I had an air mattress, I blew it up. It was like 10 inches off the floor. My dog Pork Chop was with me. He jumped on the air mattress beside me. I put my elbows on my knees and I said, you know what, Annie, you have to get your shit together. So I lived like that for a year. And I did a lot of walking and reading and getting counsel from people that I trusted. And I came up with these 10 lines in the sand for myself that I said, this, from this day forward, this is how I'm going to live my life. And I was telling a friend about it one day, and she said, you ought to share this with people. And I said, you know what? I didn't do this to share it with people. I did this to save myself. And she says, no, you really ought to share this with people. How about you do one of your lines for our annual retreat? I said, okay. So I did the finance line for them. And then after that, she said, you really ought to share this with people, Annie. And I said, okay. So I put a beta group of people together, and we met once a month for a year in my barn. And I wrote the content for this course called Lines in the Sand. And we tweaked it, and I rearranged it a little bit. And after that, I kept teaching live courses, which I love. I love to teach. Those participants all said, oh, you've got to create this so you can share with more people in the world. And I said, oh, what do you mean? They said, you've got to create this online. So we've just launched the online course for Lines in the Sand. But that's a long story to say, you never know. You just never know what's going to come at you. And you never know what's going to come out of what came out at you, right? I had no intention 5-6 years ago to have created an online course, but I did. And the good news is I think it'll serve a lot of people, and it's been a lot of fun. It's been a journey of love and learning, and I am really excited about it, and glad that you asked me about it, and hopefully a lot of people will benefit from it.
Yeah, no, I dig it. Yeah, and you're so right. You know, and again, some of those low moments when we're going through them are so tough, but they become our best growth moments, our greatest assets. And one door shuts, it creates the room for the other door to open. And so when it comes to the 10 lines in the sand, you know, or if somebody wants to, I guess, learn more about what all this is, you know, with what you're doing, I mean, kind of give us an idea of who the training is for and kind of what you guys do inside or with the training that you do, in the courses and the live training that you do.
It's for anyone who wants to create a life they love. I think so much of the time we are, you know, this thing called human conditioning can be a really crappy thing. And the good and the not so good news is it starts when we're fairly young. I truly believe we're born our best selves. And then we have these really well-intentioned people, usually our parents, right, or guardians of some sort, who layer on us their belief systems. And their belief systems probably came from the belief systems of their parents or guardians. So it's general.
Time out. Joshua Smith here at GSD Studios. I need to take a quick pause to give our sponsors a quick shout out that make all this possible. Our first sponsor is my personal 90-day mastery bootcamp. This is my personal mentorship training program where I give you everything I do inside my business. You get my entire playbook. We have 12 live 3+ hour long sessions, in addition to a ton of different bonus content. You get daily access to me. There's nothing I withhold from you guys inside this program. You get my entire playbook that's helped me sell thousands and thousands and thousands of homes. You get all my tracking forms, presentations, scripts, checklists, team contracts. There's nothing you don't get access to. This is hands down the most effective and affordable real estate training program on the planet. So make sure you check us out at www.90daymastery.com. You can check out boot camp dates. You can check out testimonials, more in-depth information. If you decide to register, make sure to enter live mastery, all caps, all one word, all together. That'll save you 500 bones. So you can get the whole entire program for only $997 or three payments of $333. Our next sponsor is PerfectStormNow.com. PerfectStormNow.com is an insanely effective lead generation website for realtors and now offers a website and CRM combo with all my custom personal follow-up drips inside there, some of which go out 1,000 plus days. We've made it where this is dummy proof, you guys. Any type of a lead generation tactic you can think of, from expireds, FSBOs, sign calls, open houses, past clients, everything is in there. It's a plug and play system. And this system really is as powerful, if not more powerful, in my opinion. I'm a little biased, but as powerful as the $1,000 a month programs out there, and it's only $199 per month. So again, check us out, www.perfectstormnow.com. Our third sponsor is EMF. Optimized Life Nutrition has created the most powerful nootropic on the planet called EMF. EMF stands for Energy, Memory, Focus. So if you're like me and you want to have insane energy, improved memory, and extreme intense focus, this is the best product money can buy. I take it every single day and the results are insane. I've massively improved energy, memory, focus, mood, awareness, and you know, like you've heard me say in the past, we've had clients that even say it enhances sex. We've had talked to people that have reduced anxiety. The supplement is insane. Check us out. Learn more at www.optimizedlifenutrition.com. Lastly, if you're like myself and our whole entire crew here at GSD Studios and my real estate team, make sure you check out our apparel line, right? We got t-shirts, men's t-shirts, women's t-shirts. We got our hat line that if you're watching this might be available at this point. The hats are in production right now. We're going to be adding a lot of different apparel. So make sure to check that out. And then also, if you're not already, make sure to jump into the GSD Mode Facebook private group. For example, inside there, you guys, we post all of our interviews to make sure that you're not missing out on any interviews. We're going to be doing some votes for future apparel, some Facebook Live stuff. So it's a free private mastermind that you can jump in to go out there, learn, grow, and continue kicking ass and succeeding. All right, that's enough of the interruptions. Let's get back to the show.
Operational. And we don't understand until we get to be a certain age that we don't have to buy into those beliefs, and we can kind of look at everything we know to be true and say, I'm going to question that. And so this really is a course for people, or an opportunity for people, to peel back the layers of everything they thought was true and then rebuild again and really come to grips and embrace who they really are from the inside out, and really have a look at 9 domains in their lives: relationships, families, vocation, what they do for leisure, what they do with friends, and understand how they can come full circle on all of those different aspects of their lives and live a life that's simple and joyful and really abundant. I would say for right now, at least, the majority of the participants have been women. The course probably has a little bit of a lean toward that. We have a few gentlemen in the live course right now. And so our next goal is to create a course that's really much more focused on men.
Yep. Now, you know, because it's one of those things where, I mean, life at the end of the day is so brief. You know, when I was in college, I worked at the local hospital on the hospice floor. And I was a nurse's aide, so I spent all these hours with all these patients on their deathbed. And, you know, one thing that's always stuck with me from that experience is not one of the patients ever was like, oh, life was amazing, life was epic, I'm ready for the next, you know, the next journey, whatever that may be. Everybody had this massive shoulda, woulda, coulda list. You could see the pain in their eyes, like, oh, crap, I just pissed away this gift called life I'm blessed with. And when you break it down, people spend more time designing their grocery list than they ever do their life plan. And it's scary. You know, no wonder so many people are just so unfulfilled in this life.
Yeah, and then they get to their deathbed and, if I only had more time, I wish I'd done this, like you said. And, you know, the great news for us is every day we get to choose how we're going to live our life. And we can choose ordinary or we can choose extraordinary. We can choose ordinary that's black and white, or we can choose extraordinary that's all kinds of colors. And I think what people are unwilling to do is take responsibility for the choices they've made, because you and I and all of our listeners are in our life right now because of the choices we've made up until this point. And some things have happened that maybe we didn't have as much control over, but still we had a choice about what meaning we were going to give to that event. And so I think we really have to come back and take personal responsibility for the choices we make, and know that any point in time, any day, you can change your entire life by making a different choice. And I think, you know, life isn't near as difficult as we like to make it. It's really pretty simple if we just let it be.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. So you talked a lot about getting out and being in nature, which I'm a big fan of. You know, I mean, I live in a bigger city in Phoenix, Arizona, but as much as I possibly can, I love to go hike and snowboard and getting out about with our family. And that's really seems where all the great ideas come from when you kind of detach from it. And, you know, what scares me so much these days is, you know, with these quote unquote smartphones that are really making us more dumb as a society, you know, we'd never get a point where we're in solitude or detached. People can't even spend 5 minutes by themselves, and then, you know, all the comparison that comes into play with social media and other things. And you know, what's some recommendations of, you know, because people hear about the whole, you know, getting out in nature, you know, they probably come up with 1,000 excuses of why they can't, you know, kind of can you elaborate on the importance of that and maybe detaching from, you know, just the busyness of that exists in our worlds today?
Well, once again, it's a choice. And usually my first question to people who want to be glued to their cell phone is, how's that working out for you, and how fulfilling is that? How fulfilling is your life? And even the comparison's a choice. We get to decide who we truly want to be in the world. And then we have to decide that we're going to allow ourselves to hold a space for that trueness of us, regardless of what's going on around us. I have a friend of mine. She said something really impactful one day. We were talking about what gives you peace. And she said, I just be peace. And I thought, wow, that's terrific. I just be what I want to be. And so I think we, each of us as individuals, have to decide, how do we want our life to feel and look and smell and taste? And then we have to make the choices and take the accountability and the responsibility to get ourselves there. And like I said, it's not near as difficult as we like to make it, but we do have to make draw some lines in the sand, if you will, and make some choices. It's just like, if you decide you're going to have children, guess what? Life's going to be pretty crazy for a lot of years. that's just part of the consequence that comes along with having kids, right? If you decide you're going to live in a city versus in a more nature-driven area like I do, then there's consequences to that. And so I think the key is to really spend time in a state of personal confrontation, because the blessing in that is it allows you to really understand who you are and what you want your life to be about.
Yep, love it. So, you know, one thing a lot of entrepreneurs struggle with, and I know this was something that I've struggled with at points in my life, is on the path to success, if you will, you know, it kind of becomes a lonely world, right? Because as you're leveling up, you know, the kind of the circle that you were surrounded with, you know, they don't quite understand you and your drive and where you're going, and no longer can you really relate to them. And, you know, it gets hard to get the buy-in from your family members, because they're always, well, slow down, enjoy life, you know, life's not about, you know, whatever it may be. And you get all these voices in your head. And, you know, I don't know if you personally struggle with that as you were creating the success, but what kind of advice would you give to our listeners that are maybe in that point in their life and are really struggling with that, with getting that buy-in and how to handle that?
The first thing I would suggest everybody do for themselves is define what success means to them. And I invite people to make it something that they feel often. So for me, my definition of success is I learn something every day. I learn a lot every day. So every day is successful for me. Some people's definition of success is when I have a net worth of $1 million. Well, guess what? You're not going to experience success every day if that's a goal of yours or what your definition of success is, because there's a pathway that you have to get there. So defining what success is and coming up with a definition that gives you that feeling often, if not daily, at least once or twice a week. The other thing is, I encourage people not to get too wrapped up in what other people think of them, because quite frankly, it's none of your business anyway. And most of the time, what other people think of you has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with them. So I don't plug into that. I don't have time for it. I don't have room for it. It doesn't bring me any peace or joy. And so it's really easy for me. It's like, they're going to think what they think regardless of what I say or whatnot. I'm just going to continue to behave in a manner that is very aligned with my values and that gives me peace and joy and simplicity in my life.
Yep, love it. So, we've heard this not just in business, but in all realms of life, but that you are the average of the five people that you spend the most time with, right? So it's so critical to make sure that you're surrounding yourself with like-minded people, and you know, but a lot of people have a tough time reaching up, if you will, for friends or making, eliminating certain people for their lives so they can make room for the right people. I mean, number one, have you found that statement to be true in your world? And then if so, like, what have you done to make sure that you are aligning yourself with the right people and making sure that you're not aligning yourself with the wrong people?
I think it's true. My values check-in, my GPS system helps me a lot. So I would encourage people to think about that. The other thing is, maybe it's not people, at least that you physically surround yourself with. Maybe it's you get that mentorship and that inspiration through people who've been there before. There's a ton of great books out there, and some of the authors are still living and some of them aren't. You know, I read one or two books a week, and I get a lot of inspiration from that. I think that the other thing that I recommend people do is spend time with yourself. Get to know and like yourself. And then when you figure out who you really are, then be that person. Consistently be that person. And then spend time with yourself every single day. I suggest quiet time for people every day. I suggest mornings over evenings. Doesn't matter. Maybe you do it on both ends of the day. But I think in the morning, it really allows you to set the tone for your day. You can sit and read a chapter in a book or write in your journal or do some exercise or I don't like the word meditation. People seem to get a little off kilter when you say that. But just that time where you're reflecting and spending time by yourself. Doesn't have to be a lot of time to start with. Maybe you can only do it for a couple of minutes. And then you practice till you get up to 10 minutes and then 15 minutes. But it matters and it makes a huge difference. And that really is what kind of keeps me focused and in the saddle all day long. Is I start my day like that and I generally end my day like that too. And so it's kind of one of those pillars that I can hold on to and I know I'm on solid ground regardless of what comes at me during the day. And I also find that if I let my ego not be part of how I react to situations, then nothing can pull you off center. Because ego is fear driven, right? And if you really go to your higher, deeper self, that's really more love based, not to sound weird, but it's a much more pure and empathetic place to approach your day, not only for yourself, but in as you relate to others throughout the day as well.
Yeah, no, I love that. So when you have, because you know, I used to struggle with spending any time in solitude, right? You know, but when I track back and reflect back in those points in my life, it was when I was most unfulfilled and depressed, and you know, I couldn't spend 2 minutes alone by myself, you know, right? And now I've gotten to the point where I have to spend 3 hours, like I get up super early just so I can have that solitude time to start my day, and it's been so powerful. Do you have, I mean, I know that you, sounds like you have a pretty in-depth daily routine that you go through with your solitude and with your self-development. Is there anything else that you do in your daily routine as far as kind of planning and reflection that you do that really kind of puts you in your power to be at your best self each day?
Yes. In addition to, I spend from 4 a.m. to 5 a.m. every day in my, I call it the hour of the soul. That's my quiet time. So I might read, I might journal, I might pull out some, I created a product called the Beatitudes Kit. So they're just words that are kind of tone setting words. So I really get myself centered in a solid place to move forward from that. Then the next thing I do, the first thing I do when I get to my office, and I get to my office pretty early, is I open my calendar up and I always list my things to do for the day with the, I like to call it the shit sandwich at the top, because if I get that out of the way, the rest of the day, by the end of the day, I'm doing the thing I love to do the most, right? So I really prioritize my things, and the things that are most distasteful, get them off your plate first. Don't procrastinate. Don't leave it till the last. It really helps me stay focused that way. And then I also end my day in nature somehow, whether it's a walk. I'm fortunate. I live in an area where I have my own barn and, you know, 5 or 6 acres that I'm surrounded with. So that's a thing that not everybody has access to at their property, but they can certainly find a park or somewhere to get to. And then finally, at the end of the day, when I put my head on my pillow, I always ask myself, did you do your best today? And some days my best isn't as good as my other days, but as long as I can answer that question yes, then I feel pretty comfortable. If I answer it not probably as good as I could do, then I reflect on how I could change that or what I learned from whatever created that question in my mind. So I kind of bookend my day with those kinds of things, and it really helps me stay focused.
Yep, no, I love that. So then when you're doing, because, you know, again, so many people just operate their lives in this kind of this fast pace, reactive pace, like they get up, you know, they hit the snooze button 3 times and get up with just enough time, and they're reactive all day and they don't take that time to really reflect and you know, so I know you've got your morning and your evening reflection, but do you take time when you get done with like each activity, let's just say, to kind of reflect on that, to know how you should categorize your day and you know, where you're at your best self, where you're your worst self, if you will, and to organize that in order to, so you can eat that shit sandwich, you know, right?
That's right. I do. I also work out 3 times a week consistently. Never miss it. It's just part of my day. The other great thing that I get the opportunity to do is I bring my dog to work with me every day. And his name is Two Socks. So Two Socks and I take frequent walks during the day because it's good for him. He needs to go out and spend some time outside. And that's usually either I generally like to take those walks before I know I'm going to have a phone call that might be a little challenging, or I know I'm going to have a conversation with one of my teammates that might be a little challenging, or we're going to talk about things that, you know, are going to be a little, the discussion's going to be hard. And that helps me once again, just breathe in the nature, breathe in the fresh air, get my ego. I kind of toss my ego off into the weeds somewhere and really come at my day from a place of presence, not thinking about 10 minutes from now and not begrudging what happened yesterday or 2 weeks ago, but really staying, like I say, keeping my ass in the saddle and in my interactions with myself and with others, coming from a place of centeredness and presence and a solid place of knowing, if you will.
Yep. Yep. Awesome. So, you know, ego, and I agree with you so much on ego being such a, you know, look at ego probably stifling more people's success than in every aspect of life than really anything else. How do you know, you know, if a response or an emotion for you personally is coming from ego or not, and making sure that you don't respond from ego? Because, I mean, it's a hard thing to do, right?
It is. It's, I know because of how I feel. When ego's involved, I don't feel good. There's a gut reaction to it that's not good. And so I know it and I thank it. Once again, failure's my friend, ego's my friend, fear's my friend. These guys are all my friend. They make a wonderful board of advisors if you let them. And so they keep me, boom. They say, go back home, Annie. You're getting over here in the ditch. It doesn't feel good. It's getting a little slippery and slidey, and there's all kinds of things down there that you don't need to get involved in. Get back. Go back home. That's where you belong. Stay centered. Stay focused. And so it's really a gut check with me. And if I could give advice to my younger self, it would be always go with your gut, because anytime I haven't, it's not been pretty.
Yep, I love that. Well, and then now, you know, I had a neurosurgeon on the show not too long ago, one of the top neurosurgeons on the planet, and he called the gut the second brain. There's almost as many neurons in the gut as the brain, and yeah. And there's a big belief system that the gut biome is the future of healthcare, you know, right? So there's definitely lots of massive correlations there, you know?
Yeah.
So I know you trademarked the you know, the name, if you will, Badass Soul Seeking Warrior. What does that mean? You know, if somebody were to read Badass Soul Seeking Warrior, what does that really mean?
It means that I am always looking for the best in others and wanting to inspire them to find the best in themselves. You know, I grew up on a farm with brothers and cousins that were all male and neighbors that were all male, and I was an athlete in school and those kind of things. And so I think I was a natural born badass. And I spent some time in my life fighting against that. And once again, my gut didn't feel good about that because that wasn't my authenticity that I was being. It wasn't genuine for me. So I kind of just threw my hands in the air one day and I went, you know what? I'm just a badass and that's okay. And it's not a bad thing. It's not like I'm out there, you know, hurting people or doing things that are destructive. It's just a way of being and it's a mindset. It's a mindset of take it all away, I'll do it again. It's a mindset of everything I have is enough. It's a mindset of ask me to do that, I'll figure out a way to get it done. So that's what badass means to me. Badass soul-seeking warrior is I know everyone out there has the potential to live an extraordinary life. They get to decide if they want to do it. But if I can help them along the way, I sure as heck would like to.
Yeah, no, I love that. Because a lot of people, you know, they hear the word soul and they might think of it from a religious context and not. Sounds like from your context, it's more of really just learning to be the best version of yourself and just create amazing, epic lives.
Right. And I think you're right. Some people take that and have a religious context to it. I happen to believe in God, and he's the badass of all badasses right there, I'll tell you, at least for me. but I think most of us can agree that there's something out there, whether you want to call it source, the universe, a higher power, whatever description you want to put to it, that's bigger than us. It's more powerful than us. And it sits there every day, all day long, saying, what can I do for you? And instead of opening our hearts and minds up to it, we kind of slam the door shut because it doesn't meet our definition of what is comfortable for us, right? So I say, bring it. You know, I have the best warrior surrounding me all day, every day, and I love it, and I'm comfortable with it, and I feel so blessed and grateful for it.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. So, you know, we find that good very quickly becomes the worst enemy to greatness. You know, you get to a point in life, or a lot of people do anyway, where, you know, good enough, it becomes good enough. Hey, you know, I've got great income coming in. I've got, you know, all this stuff, which is good enough. And they stop really going after that greatness and leveling up. What keeps you personally leveling up in life and never accepting good enough and always striving for more?
Well, it goes back for me of continually living in a place of self-confrontation. And it's not in a confronting way as much as it kind of holds my feet to the fire to what's next for me. And then continuing to ask what life wants of me. You know, have I filled up that destiny to the point where I'm happy and satisfied? And so for me, as I start each day and throughout the day, I often will ask, even sometimes when I'm pondering something or I'm not exactly sure about something, if I ask the question, what does this want from me? And I allow myself to be quiet and hear the whispers of destiny, and they're out there, there are signs everywhere, and be patient with the answer coming, it always comes. It always does. So I would you know, suggest people consider asking, you know, what does life want from me? And then sometimes everybody, like I said earlier, everybody's wired different. What's satisfying to you and I is going to be a lot different than what's satisfying to our neighbor or our cousin or our brother or sister. And so we all have to find what it is about ourselves that's satisfying and to not ignore, but not really put a whole lot of credence into the noise that's coming from the outside about it.
Yep. So you talked a lot about, you know, self-development and reading. And I know I can't stand when I get this question because there's so many amazing books that have had such amazing impact on my life. But I want to ask it, you know, anyways, you know, with all the self-development that you've done, which is such a critical component to, I think, all of our lives, you know, what have been some of the most impactful books that have that you'd recommend to our audience that have really just kind of turned your belief systems around and really helped you become the person that you are today?
Oh my gosh, there's so many great books out there. Well, I really have enjoyed and benefited tremendously from Tony Robbins' books. He's got several out there. He currently is looking at things in the financial world, which I think is useful for a lot of people to look at. So I've read all of his books. There's a book called Essentialism that I think is brilliant for entrepreneurs to read because it really helps us focus on the one thing that's going to add value to our enterprise or to our situation. There's another book by Wayne Dyer called Wishes Fulfilled. I think he wrote it just before he died a couple years ago. And there's nonfiction books. I love The Fountainhead by Ayn Rand and Atlas Shrugged. Those are really great books, and there's a lot of great messages in them. And putting politics and those kinds of things aside, there's a lot of things that I've garnered from reading books like that. I could go on and on and on. You can go to my website. I have books that I recommend. The Prophet's a great book. The Four Agreements is a great book. So many, like you said. I have a huge library of books that I've read over and over again too.
Yeah, awesome, love it. So what is we've talked about some of the events that you do and products that you do, and I know you've got a lot of different products, online products, you have your live events. Where's the best place for our listeners to go to learn more about you, to check out your products and check out your book list, and again, just learn more about you?
You can go to the website. It's Meet Me at the Barn. So meetatthebarn.com, meetmeatthebarn.com. And that's really where you'll find the most about me. The other company that we own, and you can learn more about what I do with business partners, is called Evolve Physical Therapy and Advanced Wellness. And the website for that is K like kangaroo, G like Georgia, P like Paul, T like Tom.com, KGPT.com. And we do a lot in this business to help people from their wellness and physical lives.
Yeah, awesome. And those that are watching and listening, we'll have links right below where you can just click, go check those out right away, and go see those. So I know that you do a lot of, a lot of these interviews like this, and of course you have a lot of clients reaching out or people reaching out for consulting and, advice, if you will, from you. Is there ever any questions that nobody really ever asks you that you're like, you just wish people would ask you because they're so important that you just seem to never get asked?
Let's see. Is there any questions in it? No. I can't really think of anything right now, Joshua. For me, I have such a great life, and I think maybe the question people don't ask me, but has really kind of created what I'm doing now, is what have been the greatest gifts in your life? And I would have to tell you, as odd as it might sound, the greatest gifts in my life were when my dad died, when my house burned to the ground, when my relationship was over, and that's what created everything I'm doing now. That was kind of my wake-up call. I think the universe or God or whatever people want to say was putting a lot of signs in front of me, and I was not paying very close attention. So he said, here, how's this? Wake up. And every single one of those events, as challenging and heartbreaking as it was in the moment, when I've had the luxury of getting some distance from it, I look back and I can't express how grateful I am that those things happened to me. And what came as a result has just been a true blessing, and there's been so much abundance as a result of it.
Yeah, it's one of those things where, it seems like successful people, one common trait they all have is they do use pain as their best friend. It's like you said, it is, God or the universe or whatever, delivering that pain to wake us up, and becomes our greatest growth moments. And it seems like your average out there, they're doing everything they can to avoid pain, to avoid failure. And successful people are like running to it, right? Because those do become so much of our greatest assets.
Exactly. I like to spend time out of my comfort zone because that's when I get better than I am right now. A couple years ago, a friend of mine was taking painting lessons. I thought, I want to learn to paint, right? So we got a handful of friends together and we started taking painting lessons. Now that took me way out in the weeds as far as my comfort zone goes. But it was good for me because I wasn't sitting behind a computer all day. I wasn't crunching numbers. I wasn't being so cerebral about life. It created an opportunity for me to open up that creative side of my life, and I love it. I absolutely love and adore it, and I've actually gotten some pretty good paintings under my belt now. And, you know, my next thing I'm going to learn to do is probably do knitting, as crazy as that sounds, but I've never done that before. And so I always want to push myself into that place of discomfort, because in my mind, that's where the magic is. It's out there. It's not holding on to the side of the pool, right? Nothing magical happens when you're holding on to the side of the pool. You got to let loose and go out there and see what happens. So it's kind of like my, I'm a discomfort junkie, if you will.
Yeah. That's awesome though. You know, cause I mean, it's one of those things in life, right? Well, if you're not growing, you're decaying, you know, there's no really such thing as stability. And you see this a lot of times with people that retire. It seems like for every year that they're retired, they've aged five. And it's not that I have a beef with retirement, but they don't have any more growth plans to challenge themselves, whether it's something like painting or knitting or learning to dance or, you know, whatever that continues to challenge yourself in those realms and continue as growing as humans.
Well, and you know what? Some people just don't know how to challenge themselves. They just, like I said, this whole thing about wiring and human conditioning can really help or hinder us. And it's our choice as to how we're going to deal with that. And that's another reason that I decided, you know what? If these 10 lines in the sand that came as a result of me needing to save myself and redesign my life can help somebody else, then heck yeah, I'm going to do this. Because if these people don't know how to do it now, and I can do something that inspires them to get interested in it and maybe scratch the surface a little bit, and it changes their life, or it puts a different stunning perspective on something that used to be gray and white, and now it's all kinds of reds and turquoises and bright blues and sunny and sparkly, great, you know? So that's why I think, too, we as entrepreneurs and individuals, how we be in the world, an expression of who we truly are, can have a huge impact on other people. Because you don't have to say anything sometimes, and you can change someone else's life just by how you present yourself in the world. From your true essence, right?
Yep. No, I love that. So,
you know, so I say be your best self. You know, go out there and rock it every day.
Yep.
You never know who somebody might notice it. They may not say anything, or you may not say anything to them. It could change their whole life.
Yep. It's, you know, I had a guest on recently that compared it to like snowflakes, you know, right? Yeah, it's all made out of the same material. They're all falling down, but every single snowflake's unique. And most people don't appreciate or their own uniqueness. They're trying to transform themselves into the other snowflakes. And, you know, they're not just being them from their own essence. And especially, you know, with social media, what it comes down today, it's, you know, it's scary, you know, right? Of what we're seeing out there.
It's troubling for sure. But the good news is, like we talked about earlier, we have a choice in the matter. There's a great story about these identical twins. They were raised in the same house, same parents, same atmosphere for the majority of their years, high school years, and then they left home. And one of the brothers went on to abuse his wife. He was horrible to his children, and he ends up in the slammer, right? The other guy, he becomes the greatest husband and father you could imagine, and a pillar in his community. And these twin brothers were interviewed on the same day, but separately from one another by an interviewer. And among all the questions that the interviewer asked him was this: what do you attribute you ending up in your life where you are right now? They both had the exact same answer. And the answer was, with a father like mine, what else would you expect?
Yeah.
So we get to choose the meaning we're going to give to situations. So I say, you know, choose wisely.
No, I love that. That's awesome. So, yeah, I created this podcast because I want to do, there's so much information out there, and there's a lot of great information, but there's a lot of bad information. There's a lot of smoke and mirrors out there, and it's difficult to, you know, especially for entrepreneurs or those wanting to jump into entrepreneurship, to get the right information. Because there's, you know, again, all these quote unquote gurus, everybody's a guru these days, you know, right? So I wanted to create a space where we just go out there and interview the doers, extremely successful people like yourself that are in the trenches, that are actually doing it. So our listeners can learn from. And on a selfish standpoint, I get to pick brilliant minds like yours all day. So it's you know, it's an amazing experience for me as well. So with that being said, our listeners are here because they want to go out there and create this amazing, big, epic, amazing lives for themselves. Do you have any last words of maybe advice or inspiration that you'd like to leave them with so they can go out there and do exactly that?
Well, I hate to sound redundant, but I really encourage everyone to get to know themselves on a really deep and meaningful level, and then be that person. And if you be that person with yourself, you'll be that person in the world. And like we just talked about, you never know who that's going to influence. And then spend time with that person every day, your true self, and really hone and really, you know, you have to hold your feet to the fire to create and sustain a life you love. It's just not a place you arrive at and then all of a sudden everything's good. You just don't have to do anything. It's with anything. Greatness takes practice, and the willingness to stay in the mode of practicing a fulfilling life every day is time well spent, for sure. And I suppose the last thing I would say to people is have the courage to let go of the side of the pool. Get out there and get in that place of where the magic is.
Yeah, love it. Such powerful words. And to our listeners, I know I end every podcast with this, you guys, but information without implementation is truly just the start of delusion. Information is no longer power. It's taking that information, taking action on it, that then creates power in your lives and in your world. And Annie shared just so many amazing pieces of advice, whether it's about your business or your life. Make something that you, that or take something that you learned today from Annie and go out there and apply it immediately. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. Go out there and take immediate action. And again, below is going to be links to Annie's website. For you guys to make sure you check those out. So do that. And Annie, I know how busy you are. I truly, truly appreciate you taking time out of your busy day to be here. This has been a massive honor.
It's been a pleasure, and it's great to have a new friend in you. Thank you.
Hey, yeah, absolutely, 100%. And thank you so much, and we will see you guys next time.
All right, peeps, that wraps up today's show. Again, thank you so much for watching the show. I truly appreciate it. Just a few quick reminders and favors that I need from you. Number one, please share the show. Anyone you feel can benefit from this show, this truly helps us show, grow the show, continue going out there and having impacts on many, many lives. So it'd mean the world to me if you went out there and shared the show. Number two, if you haven't done so already, make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Also, please go out there on iTunes, Stitcher, leave us a five-star positive review. All that stuff helps for awareness of the show. Also, make sure to join the GSD Mode private Facebook mastermind group. If you haven't already, you can go to gsdmode.com. Right on the front page, there's a link there. Click that. We'll get you added right away. A lot of cool stuff in there. A lot of masterminds. We're bringing a lot of Facebook Live, different stuff in there. They have access to that you can't get anywhere else. And lastly, I want to give our sponsors a quick shout out that make this show possible. So our first sponsor is my personal 90-day mastery bootcamp. This is my personal mentorship training program where I give you everything that I do inside my business, right? You get my entire playbook. We have 12 live, 3+ hour long training sessions. You get daily access to me inside the program. There's a bunch of bonus training sessions. You get access to every single thing that I do inside my business, all my tracking forms, all my presentations, checklists, lead generation tactics, lead follow-up tactics, team contracts, and so much more, you guys. There's nothing that compares to this program. You get full access to everything that I do inside my company. I hold nothing back. Go check us out, www.90daymastery.com, where you can learn more information, see future dates, see testimonials, all that fun shite. If you decide to join, make sure to plug in Live Mastery inside the promo code, all one word, all together, all caps. That'll save you 500 bones on the program. So you get it for only $997, which is a freaking steal, or three payments of $333. Our next sponsor is PerfectStormNow.com. So PerfectStormNow.com is an insanely effective lead generation website for realtors, and now offers a website and CRM combo with all my custom personal follow-up drips, all of my scripts that are inside there, right? So there's no guesswork. And when a lead comes in, based on the lead source, you're gonna know exactly what to say, when to say, how to say. All of it's just auto-filled, and we made it where it's dummy-proof. I mean, this system is as powerful, if not more powerful, in my opinion, than $1,000-plus monthly websites, and it's only $199 a month. So go to PerfectStormNow.com. You can check out in-depth demos, see more testimonials, learn more information on it, all that cool jazz. Our last sponsor is EMF. So Optimized Life Nutrition has created the most powerful nootropic on the planet called EMF, Energy, Memory, Focus. So if you're like me and you want insane energy, improved memory, an extremely intense focus, this is the best product that money can buy you guys. I personally take it every single day before I do webinars, before I do things like this, man. I'm always taking this product to go out there and enhance, again, my focus, my intensity, my memory, every aspect of it. So go out there and check right now on www.optimizelifenutrition.com where you can learn more about EMF. Lastly, you guys, if you want to be like me and the rest of the GSD crew, as well as my real estate team and so many others that listen to the show and support the show, make sure you're rocking this GSD mode gear, man. We want to go out there and spread the love, spread the word, spread the GSD mode name. So on the site, gsdmode.com, we have men's shirts, women's shirts. We're starting to run a lot new apparel through the site, so you see a lot more coming as well. So make sure to go check out the site, pick that up, have some fun. Thank you again for watching, and we'll see you next time. Peace out.